हेलो विकास सर,
हेलो, यस
ऑल
यस
ऑल इज
वर्दस,
सेट, सो ऑल सेट अप फाइन,
यस ऑल सेट इज फाइन, माय वॉइस इज क्लियर,
यस यस यस, ओके, सो शुड वी स्टार्ट,
या वी कैन स्टार्ट, वेयर इज आई एम द सर,
ओके ही इज इन,
यस सर, यस सर,
यस ही इज हियर,
डू यू हियर मी,
या यस सर, यस सर, सो
ओके थैंक यू
सर, विद योर परमिशन सर वी स्टार्ट सर,
माय प्लेजर,
थैंक यू सर, वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू for the third session of the day two. In this session, we have Dr. I.M. Jha, Associate Professor of Political Science, ARSD College, University of Delhi. And he will be speaking on imperatives of scientific knowledge with a brief introduction. Dr. Indra Mohan Jha is Associate Professor of Political Science, ARSD College, University of Delhi. He obtained his MPhil and PhD degrees in international relations from Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. After a brief stint at Indian Express, he was associated with Center for Peace Studies, New Delhi. He has keen interest in application of Gandhian ideas to study of challenge of conflict and peace. He has worked on research projects, presented paper at national international seminar and symposia. He is also associated with research institutes. He is a senior fellow at the Center for Vietnam Studies, New Delhi. He published a range of widely over-varied aspects of international relations, including some books, SAARC, The Road Ahead, Changing Narratives of Terrorism, India Security Challenges. Apart from this, he regularly, before that, writes on web, some newspapers, and different journals. Sir, now I would like to invite you, Dr. I.M. Jha, to deliver his lecture. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I am audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're audible, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Vikas, for bestowing on me this honor to share my thoughts with my colleagues on a very significant issue that is dear to my heart. I have titled my paper, Imperatives of Scientific Knowledge. Basically, I do intend to discuss why we do science, how we do science, and when we do science, what we do in science. And therefore, in a nutshell, I can say that it is all about application of scientific knowledge in our human society. Let me begin with why science. For simple reasons, there is a very close connection between science and human progress. For the reason that science empowers, science is liberating. And whatsoever empowerment that we witness today in our human society, it is not that we have received it all of a sudden from nature or from divine. Humanity has to struggle for that. Let us take this example. In religion or in theology, man was nothing. Whereas in science, or a scientific man is everything. That brings me closer to The ancient Greece saying by Protagoras that man is the measure of everything. This is a scientific statement. That is, everything in the world, whether a perception or a judgment or a knowledge, is relative to mankind and not derivation from God. And therefore, science has brought man to the center of the universe. Or let me put it this way, science has made man everything from nothing. And those societies where people have no scientific bent of mind, there is enormous irrationality and obscurantism. That society produces everything bad, be it religion, be it culture, be it economy, be it politics. And all these bad lead to enormous human suffering that humanity has witnessed and even today we are witnessing. Therefore, in a nutshell, I would say the ultimate purpose of science is to provide a happy life, a better life, an empowered life for men. Having said so, let me directly approach the title of this FDP. The title of this FDP is Research Methodology and Research Methodology Tools and Techniques. I won't be dealing with tools and techniques. That is neither my forte, nor I do intend to repeat, because many would have done and would be doing. However, let me begin with the first aspect, that is research methodology. And to explain my position, I would begin with a saying in research methodology, and that saying is that if you are able to raise right questions, then and only thereafter you can reach or get a right answer. Here, it is important to understand that right question refers to method in research, questions, observations, and so on and so forth. Roughly, we can say question here refers to methodology or method, and right answer means you reach to truth, or what James Mill would say, truth claimed, or in this context, for my convenience, I would say scientific knowledge. Therefore, there is a deeper relationship between science, scientific knowledge, and research methodology. Let us see what is science. And that explains the relationship between science and method. Science is a systematic knowledge gained through prescriptive practices leading to prediction. Here, prescriptive practices refers to methodology, tools, and techniques. And through that, you reach to a prediction. When committee or community of scientists accept this truth, this prediction, then that prediction takes the shape of theory. That is a truth which is testified, verified, falsified. And therefore, the ultimate goal of scientific knowledge is to produce scientific endeavor or research methodology is to produce a theory. Now, and therefore, there are certain characteristics of scientific knowledge. They are, if your knowledge is scientific, it must be empirical, cumulative, objective, predictive, and theoretical. Thus, methodology and knowledge have very deeper link, let me say dialectical link. Now, to explain this link, let me take you back to who is known as the first philosopher of science, Auguste Comte. The philosophy of science of Auguste Comte is based on difference between method and science. And not only that, for Comte, he would say, science, actually he uses the term method and doctrine. Doctrine is a system of belief. In this context, for our convenience, I would say scientific knowledge or science. So he would say that it is not science is more important. What is important is method or methodology. Why he says so? He says so for the reason that doctrine or science or knowledge keeps on changing, keeps on being corrected. It is changeable. That basically refers to human progress. However, methodology remains the same. Methodology remains, and methodology, a sense of inquiry, remains the same. Therefore, for scientific knowledge, method is very, very important that you are studying and doing that. In Comte, based on this idea of methodology, there is a significant suggestion, particularly for we, the students of social sciences, because generally science wallahs, those who do science in laboratory, they would say all these history, sociology, they are not science, because science has to be done in laboratory. But I had a friend who would say that there is only one science, and that is political science. All else are physics, chemistry, and so on and so forth. So I try to bring to your notice that this problem of science or no science is a serious problem in humanities foremost and social science even today. But Comte would say that philosophically, there is no fundamental difference between empirical science or natural science or social science, and to some extent, I would say between even in humanities as well, though it's highly disputed. Why he says so? He says so that knowledge cannot be divided. Knowledge cannot be categorized hierarchically, better or worse, good or bad. Knowledge is knowledge. Science is science. What changes in different discipline is different use of different methods. Like he would cite the example that if you are doing astronomy, you do observation. If you are doing physics, you do experimentation. If you do biology, you do comparison. Therefore, he talks of unity of knowledge and discipline and sciences. I am sorry using all these terms interchangeably. However, his idea of unity is not something like chemical unity. It's not chemical unity. His only purpose was to emphasize that there cannot be fragmentation of knowledge, whether of natural science or social sciences. Now, it is important and instructive as well to understand that why Comte emphasizes methodology so much. The fundamental reason lies in the etymological explanation or literal meaning of method. What is method? Method simply is right application of reason. Right application of reason. Now, if you apply your reason rightly, then you act and act in a right direction. That means, or that leads you to your progress, either material condition, metaphysical condition, a spiritual condition, or scientific knowledge. Now, therefore, he had a slogan. Comte had a slogan: from science comes prevision, from prevision comes action. That is, if you have scientific bent of mind, if you explain things scientifically, then you can foresee the future. And unless you foresee the future, you cannot act. Therefore, Comte would say that human actions take place within the limits of nature, but that human action works to replace that natural limitations to artificial one. And whatever human development we find is that change, artificial, whether of knowledge or civilizational goals. It is the rational creation by human action. Now, on this basis of significance of method and unity of sciences, Comte proposes a positive science of society. Why he says that there can be a science of society, that is the social science? His argument is that if one can use the methods and assumptions of natural sciences, then social sciences can be similar to natural sciences. That he would call a positive science of society. And why he says so? His argument is based on this assumption that human behavior, like matter is the domain of natural sciences. Human behavior is the domain of social sciences or humanity. So, like matter, human behavior is also governed by the principle or laws of cause and effect. Cause and effect, that is, cause and effect. Therefore, there is no fundamental difference in the behavior of matter and man. And therefore, he would say, like matter, man changes his or her behavior in the face of application of external stimulus, and that behavior can be observed. Here he would warn that in social sciences, or when we produce a positive science of society, we should only calculate or try to understand which is observable. We should not try to understand human emotions, human feelings, values, virtues, because they are misleading. Therefore, whatever is observable, it must be observed. Now, this idea of causality and relationship, this idea of externality was used by many scholars. Very prominently, I refer to Emil Durkheim. In his study, in his sociological method, you know, he would say that social facts are things. What does it mean when he says social facts are things? He basically meant that so if a fact is thing can be observed, evaluated, calculated by rational laws of our society. And he cites the example of suicide. That is, ordinarily we do believe that suicide is individual. But Durkheim would say, no, sir, suicide is not individual. It is not psychological. It is social, because certain social stimulus acts on individual, which changes man's behavior. Therefore, this relationship of externality and causality became an important factor in the study of science. This was also used, or the similar argument was also used by Karl Marx. What is the explanation or central theme of Karl Marx explaining politics, culture, society, everything, ideas, everything? It is the relationship between base and superstructure. So base is cause and superstructure is effect. Now, there is no disagreement, or as the Marxists themselves claimed, that Marxism, what they called Marxism, it is scientific socialism. It is this socialism, only Marxist socialism is scientific. Therefore, this issue of causality and external stimuli is very important in the understanding of science. However, there emerged a problem. Many people challenge, because when you apply externality or external stimulus on matter reacts similarly. because matter is unconscious, but man is conscious. So water, normal water, will boil everywhere at 100 degrees Celsius. Means there is predictability in the nature of water, because water is matter, it is not conscious. Whereas man is conscious, man thinks, and therefore there is possibility that every man may not react similarly in similar situation, in similar situation with similar stimulus. Therefore, it is said that mere rational observation of human society or human behavior is not possible. Then what is the answer? Phenomenologists tried to answer that. And the answer is that you must add observation with theoretical interpretation of subjective state of mind of action. Theoretical interpretation of subjective state of mind of action. Here comes subjectivity, because the moment you lead to interpretation, subjectivity creeps in. Therefore, this issue of subjectivity and objectivity is a serious problem in a study of science, more particularly in humanities. Now, all through whatever I have discussed, I find that there is a recurrent theme in science, reason in action. In a nutshell, or to put it different way, that you can say, what is science? One can argue very easily that science is reason in action. But when we talk about reason in action, man did not inherit this reason in action so easily, because before 15th century, roughly before 15th century, the period was called the Dark Ages. In Dark Ages, there was no concept of man as thinking and acting. However, over a period of time, certain changes took place, and that is called the era of enlightenment. And whatever science and technology, whether it is humanities or social sciences that we witness, are rooted in the thinkers, philosophers of enlightenment era. Therefore, it is important to understand what was the major contribution and why enlightenment is said to be the originator of modern science or scientific knowledge. Here I would refer to a very small piece, but highly enlightening piece that titled "What is Enlightenment?" by Immanuel Kant, 1784. Immanuel Kant explained, whatever I have talked, the importance of reason, that is duly, properly explained by Immanuel Kant in this seminal essay titled "What is Enlightenment?" Kant has explained enlightenment something like this. Enlightenment is man's emergence from self-incurred immaturity. Man's emergence, moving ahead from self-incurred immaturity. And what he meant by immaturity? By immaturity, he simply meant, hello? Hello.
Hello, sir. Audible now. Audible now.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So for Kant, enlightenment was man's emergence from his self-incurred immaturity. How he defines immaturity? Man's inability to use his own understanding, and he uses that understanding with the guidance of someone else. So he is enlightened, who is empowered, who has courage to use his reason or understanding himself, not through the guidance of someone else. This is very significant. And he would say that immaturity is very convenient, because everything for you is done by someone else. Everything for you is done by someone else. And I myself experience, like, I don't know all these computer, someone else does for me. I have nothing to do. I don't know to drive, someone else would drive for me. It is very convenient for me. But then it is highly idiotic of me that why I don't know. I have to be dependent on someone else. A man who is dependent on someone else is not a rational man. He cannot say what he wants to say. Therefore, Kant would say that man must have courage or resolution. Courage, he uses the term courage and resolution to use his knowledge, to use his knowledge. That is his enlightenment, that is his emancipation. And he uses the old slogan, that is sapere aude, have courage to use your reason, have courage to be wise. Now, in all this process, Kant would say that there are n number of chains that society has imposed on man, and the guardians of that man would say, if you try to venture out to become mature, that is to use your knowledge, it is not only difficult, it is dangerous also. Therefore, don't venture out. Whatever I say, you must do that. And he would say, religion is the most pernicious dogma or chain against mankind, and therefore we must get rid of it. However, as a father of libertarian values, Kant won't suggest that there may be some revolution, there may be some revolution for this maturity of man or man becoming enlightenment. He would say it may be slow, but very significantly, metaphysics or theology would say that some man, rare man, can be enlightened. Kant would say it can be societal. Every man in every sphere can use his or her knowledge or wisdom to create a better society. Therefore, this public use of reason is very significant for human liberation, for the rise of scientific knowledge. And he would conclude with a very remarkable statement, and that a very remarkable statement, that is the germ on which, please listen carefully, the germ on which nature has lavished most care is man's inclination and vocation to think freely. Man's inclination and vocation to think freely. Therefore, I can say that the seeds of modern science, if sown in enlightenment, it was through human freedom to think freely, to use his or her reason, rationality very freely. Having said so, on this basis of freedom of thought and methodology, science continued for quite some time. However, that is, you made new innovations. Man reinterpreted the movement of planets. It was not that sun revolved around the earth. Galileo and Copernicus suggested other way around, that earth revolves around the sun and things like that. From Aristotelian mechanics to Newtonian mechanics to quantum physics and so on and so forth. So we had for quite some time very significant scientific practices and development that was based on historical linkage of one knowledge against another. However, this whole idea, and this is called Whig interpretation of history. Whig interpretation of history. The nomenclature Whig is derived from the Britishers, those who supported the power to the parliament were called Whigs, and those who supported more power to the king were called Tories. So you see, Whigs are those who believe in change, and that change was a continuous process. So in early 1960s, to be precise, in 1962, what a coincidence and paradoxical coincidence, a quantum physicist changed the whole idea of philosophy of science. Here, look the paradox. He was not a scientist. He was not a philosopher, but he changed the whole idea of philosophy of science. His name was Thomas Kuhn. Thomas Kuhn was a professor of quantum mechanics, and his vice chancellor, the president of Harvard University, Conant, asked him to teach science to social science students, because Conant believed, the president of the university, Harvard University, believed that everybody who is knowledgeable, who is learned, must have some understanding of science. So Kuhn began to teach science to social science students. And in this process, he's developed interest in social science philosophy. Now, out of that interest, he produced a very, very revolutionary work that is called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions by Thomas Samuel Kuhn. That is The Structure of Scientific Revolution. And this became such a significant book that from its publication in 1962 till date, something around 1.5 million copies, 1.5 million copies have been sold. And such a cerebral work, such a significance, such a brainy work, if it sells something around 1.5 million copies, you can say it is a modern day Harry Potter variety of literature. And some commentator would say that if you have anything to do with science, I'm sorry to using a bad word, but this is not my word. Someone else had said that before you die, you must read this book by Kuhn. Why this book is so significant? Because he challenged whole idea of thinking about science. How he challenged science? Because before Kuhn, science was shrouded under the philosophical argument, not scientific argument. that is how science ought to develop. Science kaise viksit ho, hona chahiye, should ought to be, is not a scientific statement. It is philosophical, at times irrational as well. And therefore, till date, or largely, the Whig interpretation of history of science was rooted to this idea that what should be the method of science? Like we are talking about research methodology, tools and techniques, whether observation is good or sample survey is bad, you know, these are the simple things. Or some heroic invention, some new truth, or some correction. Here, one important thing continued that in all this process of science, there was emphasis on continuity of knowledge. And therefore, as I told you earlier, that the conventional science characteristic that it has to be cumulative means the knowledge of tomorrow has something to do to evolve on the knowledge of yesterday. So, past is perceived as a progression towards future, whether it is science or develop any kind of development, whether liberty or freedom, governance or anything. The past is always there without a continuity. Kuhn challenged this whole idea of continuity and nature of science. He would say that there is discontinuity and alternating nature of scientific knowledge. What he meant by discontinuity? His idea of discontinuity and alternative aspect of knowledge was based on his division of science into two kinds. One, he would say, normal science, and another he would say, revolutionary science. What he meant by normal science? He invited lots of criticism for calling normal science as puzzle solving. People got angry with him. Oh my God, he is talking such a nonsense. So science is not so simple as puzzle solving. But his argument was that in normal science, we don't get novelty. We don't get something new. We get what we expect to get. Like he has given the example of puzzle solving. In newspaper, when we solve puzzle, don't we know that someone already knows the answer of this question? We do know. The next day you get the answer of that. Not only that. I told you earlier that scientific knowledge has to be predictive. Means, if you are doing science, whatever you get new, it has to make prediction. But take this example. I am taking a dig on our physicist and chemist friends by referring to only one chemistry equation I could remember in my life. That is how to make hydrogen gas. The logic is simple. The answer is simple. Everybody knows. Even I know. If you put zinc, if you put sulfuric acid, H2SO4, on zinc, on Zn, you get hydrogen gas. This formula to produce hydrogen gas is known, I don't know for how many centuries, for how long. But still, year after year, in our science laboratories, in our chemistry laboratories, our students, guided by our teachers, do this practical of making hydrogen gas. Now the question is that why students do this? is it meaningless? Because it is not going to lead to a new prediction. After all, it is simply a postdiction because it is already known. Then why we solve puzzle? Why our students make hydrogen gas in our laboratory? What is the reason? The answer is simple. When you solve puzzle, you think, you challenge your mind, your thought process, you argue within and reason for right answer. Precisely that a student does and learns in his laboratory while trying to make hydrogen gas. So in science process, this attempt to, it's a sort of exercise. It's a sort of exercise of normal science to reaching to revolutionary science. And Kuhn cites certain examples. That is, while studying Aristotelian mechanics, he would say that it would be idiotic to say that Aristotle knew anything about mechanics. So, but that was mechanics. Because Aristotle also had something to do with motion, like Newton had to do. So, but then there were substantial difference between two and their definition. Newtonian mechanics, or the idea of motion, was simply based on that if the motion has taken place, something must move. That is, the physical position of a body must change. Whereas for Aristotle, it simply meant any kind of change. For that matter, Aristotle was kind enough to tell us that any change is a revolution. So you see, there is qualitative difference between the revolution of Aristotle and other revolutions, for that matter, the revolution of Karl Marx. Therefore, Kuhn brings in the idea of milieu, that is environment, in which a scientist works. That is again very important. The milieu in which a scientist is working, under whose guidance, who is working. And this becomes more prevalent today. Like I cite the example that every scientist would agree, or anybody or everybody who has something to do with the scientific knowledge, they would agree that science ultimately must be theoretical. We have made so much of achievement in the strides in science today, but you ask those into this business of science and scientific discovery that what is the nature of scientific discovery today? Is it theoretical? No, sir. It is data driven. It is not theory driven. Why it is happening? It is happening for the reason that those, whether governmental or private, who finance most of the cutting edge research today, they need more and more data and less and less theory. Therefore, we find there is 100% dearth or lack of theory, whether it is humanities or natural sciences. Having said so, let's take what does Kuhn meant by revolutionary science. He would say that normal science is a business as usual, but over a period of time, when crisis deepens, anomalies becomes more and more, then new things are tried. And from that new thing, new inventions and discoveries take place, which is a total break or shift from the past. And here he uses the term paradigm shift. That is what in politics we call tectonic shift. That is, totally something new has happened. And this paradigm shift became so useful and popular that everyone used it. Not only science wala's, philosophy wala's, political science wala, even management and economist and so on and so forth, everybody used it. So what he meant by paradigm shift, by paradigm shift or revolutionary science, he would say, when you make a total change from the past, and as a quantum physicist, he would say, when Max Planck invented the idea of quantum physics, it was a total shift, total break from Newtonian mechanics. And therefore, it was science and revolutionary, and rightly so. What Einstein had to suggest about quantum mechanics, quantum physics, he would say, after quantum physics, the principles of physics needs to be reformulated, rewritten. Therefore, this whole idea of new science cannot be here. One may find that what is so great about discontinuity? Why not continuity? The fundamental problem is that if you are guided by the past, if you don't break from your past, you cannot bring real change. And this real change is very significant in every aspect of life. So, Kuhn entered into dispute and debate with major scholars and philosophers of his time, more particularly someone like Karl Popper. However, Popper and Kuhn, for that matter, most of the scholars in this area, they accepted this basic theme that science has to be theoretical. However, Kuhn accepted this, but his position remained unchanged on one fact. And that idea of fact statement was that scientific knowledge or paradigm is incommensurable. That is, which scientific paradigm is better cannot objectively decide it. Thus, if you want to decide which is better, which is superior, you must have some element of subjectivity. I kept on talking about objectivity and science. Objectivity in science, but at times I refer to, not it was my personal, I am basically paraphrasing the ideas of great scholars for our convenience to explain my point. You find that subjectivity creeps in. Why it creeps in and why it is accepted? Because subjectivity, if used properly, is not bad. It challenges man to accept and learn one's limitation and limitation of science. However, ultimately, if you try to do science, then what you have to do? Your thinking must be critical. You must have critical interaction. Among the peers, there must be instigation of doubt, discussion, and disputation for fresh ideas and cognitive progress of mankind. That is, through these means, generally, one can reach to scientific discoveries, new knowledge, and new sciences. However, we have certain problem. Humanity face certain problem that I call the problem of bad science. That is, through science, man began to conquer nature. New inventions, discoveries, civilizations and civilizational growth, and so on and so forth. But what has happened? Initially, as I referred to you, what Kant would say, man's inclination and vocation for freedom of thought. If we look at this problem of science and its application, are we more free today or more in chains? Why it has happened? It has happened for the reason that man did not know the limits of use of science and how to use science. Therefore, mere over enthusiastic use of science, what I am now entering into a very difficult terrain, and I derive my inspiration from a person, unfortunately, who is most maligned and reviled in this country. I don't intend to change your political opinion, but I will request you to read Jawaharlal Nehru's few pages on religion, philosophy, and science in Discovery of India, last chapter. There, he argues that mindless use of science changed man as a geographical force, geological force. Man became a geographical force. What he meant and what man as geographical force did, man, Nehru would say, changed the chemistry and physics of the planet Earth. What he meant by changing the chemistry and physics of planet Earth? He simply meant that the natural existence, the planet meant for a happy life, science did not apply because science became bad, badly used. And we have the best or the worst example of bad science, what was also called the big science, that is the culmination of human science, human knowledge, scientific knowledge in mid 20th century, was making of nuclear bomb. Unlimited, unknown, unparalleled source of power with beyond imagination destructive capacity. Now we see, science made this bomb. How? How science emerged? Right now we talk reason, rationality, but may I ask you a question? Can a rational man, if man is rational, can he or she be self-destructive? After all, if I am a rational man, if I am thinking man, can I destroy myself? No. Can I destroy my family, my species? No. This is not rationality. This is irrationality and madness. But science applied it. Science was used and applied to this level of madness. Why it happened? Again, I will take inspiration from Nehru. He would say that human reason, that is science, might not have developed to the level that it could observe every human experience. Human knowledge, human reason has not reached to that level of development. And roughly he would say, maybe for the reason that human mind has not developed to that level, to know that, to observe that, and to get rid of that destructive proclivities of science. Therefore, Nehru always scolded the scientists. He would say, science is fine, but science must be with social responsibility. If science is devoid with social responsibility, moral values, then science is bound to be destructive. So Nehru suggested that to get rid of this destructive proclivity of science, you must know or understand something more than mere application of science. He would say the critical temper of science that became famous as scientific temper. This passage, a small one, is very dear to my heart. I beg your pardon for inflicting. And let me quote very briefly what he meant by scientific temper. By scientific temper, he meant the search for truth and new knowledge, the refusal to accept anything without testing and trial, the capacity to change previous conclusions in the face of new evidence, the reliance on observed fact and not on preconceived theory, the hard discipline of mind. That needs hard discipline of mind. Therefore, the scientific temper should be a way of life. Scientific temper should not be done merely in laboratory. It should be a way of life, a process of thinking, a method of acting and associating with fellow men, fellow human beings. The scientific temper points out the way along which man should travel. It is the temper of a free man. It is the temper of a free man. So you find the true enlightenment in Kant, or explanation of enlightenment in Kant, and Nehru's scientific temper would conclude with the same idea, the freedom of man. Because unless our thought is free, we cannot evolve or try to understand what is scientific knowledge. And therefore, often, again, I'm sorry, inflicting a bad name on you, Jawaharlal Nehru described universities stand for flight of ideas. Flight of ideas. Where there is no class of ideas, where there is no flight of ideas, science cannot emerge. There cannot be happy human existence. After all, science is not all about human building. It is not all about material existence. It is something more, far more. Friends, to neutralize my Nehru's references, let me conclude with Mahatma Gandhi and his statement, what is science and what science should be. Gandhi would say, a science to be science must afford, a science to be science must afford the fullest scope for satisfying the hunger of body, mind, and soul. That is the whole of man, whole of society. That and only that we should do science. Not science which is culturally determined, not science which is economically determined, not science which is destructive, not science which is exploitative. We must do science which is rational, humane, and humanitarian, which is for liberation of human mind and soul. Friends, thank you very much for being and bearing with me. I don't have so much research interest in this area. However, whatever fragmented thought I presented, contribution goes also to one of my friends. I thank my friend. Moreover, I talked about what should be science, but about all these ideas, I feel very emotionally. And the negative part of emotion is that at times it hurts the other side. So in any sense, intellectually, politically, if I have done disservice, I beg you, friends, and I wish you all the best. Thank you very much for being and bearing with me. Thank you very much.
I am, sir.
Yes, sir.
We have to take some questions, sir.
Oh, my God.
Yes, sir.
Please.
Yeah.
If I can.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for this wonderful lecture. And the major highlights that you have highlighted in terms of that importance of reasons, scientific knowledge, how to acquire scientific knowledge, and how to challenge scientific knowledge is great. It's very wonderful. So now we will go for some questions, because it's not possible to take all questions. So
But easier one. I am not a scholarly person. Please.
Obviously, sir. We'll take this.
Yeah.
First question, sir. Dr. Joseph John. How can there be some research from zero or nothingness from psychology point of view? How can there be some research from zero or nothingness from psychology point of view?
Sorry, I am not into psychology. And what he meant by zero and nothingness from psychology, this is not my area and I don't know. I'm sorry. If he's here, he should explain his point, then I would be benefited myself. You please give him my number and we can discuss. I will be grateful to him if he explains what he meant.
Frankly, we will pass your information, sir, to Joseph. Sir, next question is, why empirical research in India is problematic nowadays? This question from Manjur Alam. Why empirical research in India is problematic nowadays?
You see, one major question is that of funding. Because when you go for empirical research, it needs lots of funding, you know. So we have a scarcity of funds, and distribution of funds depends on so many factors. This is one major reason. Second, this is administrative, and this is a major problem of modern science team. Second problem is that we, the researchers, don't want to slog more, don't want to give more time to our research, and this is a general problem. However, I would say the other way, my problem is other way around, that in India, in most of the fields, you have minimum theoretical research. So one should go for theoretical research. This was my take on this. Thank you.
Sir, there is one question from Sarangtham, and he said that you are fabulous, sir, in your lecture, and he's a physicist. Nice. And he's just asking the question that what is the domain of humanity as a matter and society? Are the domains of natural science and social science, how does it behave?
Yeah. You see, when you talk about, you see, there are too many things. As I refer to Comte, that normally we have this misunderstanding that science means laboratory. But when you say laboratory, that basically means that you are doing physics or chemistry or biology or astronomy or medical science. When you do social science, human being, then you have to deal with human behavior. You have to deal with human emotions. And you cannot experiment in a laboratory about human behavior. Like, I may be bad man, I may be bad teacher, but I can project myself, I'm a very scholarly man. So how you explore? Therefore, as I told you, referring to Comte, that in different disciplines, your method or approach must differ. So if you want to study me, your approach has to be different from if you want to study my mobile phone or my food, you have to take different route and approach. So it is not the difference of discipline, it is difference of method. Thank you.
So there is another question by Dr. Hansraj.
Yeah.
What is metaphysics objective reality according to Immanuel Kant?
What is
metaphysics oblique objective reality according to Immanuel Kant?
Hansraj Sahab's question suggests that he knows the answer and he wants to test me. I told you at the very outset, I am not an scholarly person. Thank you. Take next one.
So next question in that sense. How rationality is different from argument and logic?
Yes. Rationality. Also, yes. Whose question?
Hansraj again.
Yes. I should not say every question, no. Rational emerges from the world, reason. And when you apply reason, you argue. You discuss. So, reason is a tool, roughly you can say a method to enter into argument. That is the thing. Yes.
Yes, sir. There's another question by Amit Kumar.
Yes.
There are certain disciplines where subjectivity of the researcher cannot be ruled out.
No, not
for instance. I got it.
You see, this is one major problem. But it's not a problem. It's a human factor. It is not certain disciplines, but it happens in every discipline. Subjectivity is there. Like I tell you, when the School of International Studies began, then if you have to study, if you have to do some research on Pakistan, you must know Urdu. Even today, if you have to do research on Bangladesh, you should know Bangla. What is this nonsense? If I don't know Bangla, cannot I do a good research on Bangladesh? Someone Bengali, with due respect, may have certain value judgment about happenings in Bengal or Bangladesh. It is social problem. For that matter, when you begin to select a topic, whether it is science or social science, you make a hunch. There is subjective element that, oh my God, if I do PhD on this, I will become this. Is it not subjective? Take this example of science. What kind of research is being done in science? And what is the basis of all those research projects? Are those scientific or subjective judgment of where from I will get the fund? So this subjectivity has to be there for simple reason that we are human beings. Science is all about minimizing your subjectivity. Minimizing your subjectivity. And maximum you minimize, maximum scientific you are. Thank you.
Sir, last question.
Yeah.
So last question, just a last question from Dr. Swati M. Viswas. Yeah. How does you relate use of science with current pandemic?
Yeah. Before we finish, let me make an appeal to all of you friends. As and when you get time and opportunity, please do read two small pieces. One by Immanuel Kant, What is Enlightenment? And another, I am not doing political exercise, please don't mind. A few pages by Jawaharlal Nehru, Religion, Science and Philosophy in Discovery of India, chapter 10, last chapter. These are wonderful pieces, easily readable, and that surely enlightens our thinking about science and society. So, old man, forgot your question, please repeat. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir, I forgot your question. Please repeat the last question.
Last question is just, sir, how you can use the science in current pandemic situation?
Yeah. First, you see, hope you remember, I had referred to Jawaharlal Nehru's idea that with mere application or bad application of science, man became a geographical force. And by geographical force, he simply meant that, these are his words, that man changed the physics and chemistry of planet Earth. Means the natural composition of Earth was plundered and destroyed by our modern science and science-geared greedy economic activities. So all these pandemics and n number of other pandemics, last time I spoke on Gandhi and I told you that we are not only suffering only one pandemic. There are ongoing pandemics that we are not said for obvious reasons. So human beings, through use of science, based on their greed, have created conditions for rise of all these pandemics. And I must tell you that the origin of pandemics or other pandemics are frequent in China, Southeast Asia. And you will find that in those parts of the world, agriculture, human culture, forest, they are all being plundered by corporate economy. So if you plunder nature, nature will pay you back with compound interest. Therefore, the answer is, if you don't want pandemics, if you don't want any other misery, forget about health challenges, any other miseries, use science judiciously, use science wisely, use science constructively, not destructively. You will have no pandemic. This is my confidence. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. With this, we come to the end of today's program. Thank you, everyone. We will join on Monday at the same time with new speakers, the new day.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Vikas, for providing me
opportunity.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Anna, bora bhag.
करता हूँ सर, मैं कुछ रिप्लाई कर रहा हूँ अभी सर।